Hi, this is Joe Osuna. Welcome to Inside the Leisure World. Today we have a guest who sees stuff that we don't see. And his name is John. Now, he has a difficult name to pronounce.
Lavick. Lavick. Just
Lavick?
Yeah, don't fight the H.
Because there's an H in there somewhere, right?
Yep. It starts with an H, but you don't pronounce it.
Okay, so that's going to be John. And John has a secret to share with us, and we'll talk about that. The way I met John was we were walking together from one conference room to another, and he points out a green thing on a wall that turns out to be a pregnant praying mantis. I would have taken it as a green leaf, but he pointed it out right away, and he knew it was a female pregnant mantis. And he told me something very interesting, and when I asked him about that, he said that the praying mantis had a very unique sex lifestyle. So, John, what's this about the praying mantis sex lifestyle? And what happens to the poor male?
Oh, the poor male. Well, insects have got segments. And in each segment, there's a little, what's called a ganglion. In the human, all the ganglia are fused into what's called the brain. But in insects, each segment retains a ganglion. So there's the head, there's a couple of thorax segments, three typically, and then abdominal segments.
And you're saying that those segments have part?
Each segment has its own little ganglion in
okay.
it. And for example, you would expect the thorax segments to control the flight of the insect if it happens to have wings, or the walking if it, well, they all have legs, but.
Okay.
So what's your name? In the praying mantis, the male cannot copulate until all the movements for sex in the male mantis are in the last ganglion, and the brain overrides that last ganglion. So until the brain is removed, the male mantid can't copulate. So the female comes along, bites off his head, and they go along and copulate, and then the female gets impregnated and will lay her eggs at some later date. So it's They're pretty feisty little creatures. If you've ever experienced them, they will lash out at you. They will go after bees. They will go after butterflies. They will go after flies. They will go after anything that moves and is edible. Okay. So mantids are, that's just the way they are. And we just happen to see it. I pick up on insects. Once you learn the secrets, it's easy.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about yourself. A little bit of experience and how you came to the leisure world and how you developed the entomology interest.
Well, my entomology, I actually remember how I developed my entomology interest. I went and took speech in high school, and we were required to give many speeches about a wide variety of things. And one of the speeches I was required to give was by a deputy secretary of the agriculture. And he mentioned that what really makes America great isn't its military prowess. What makes America great is its ability to just crank out the food.
Okay.
It resonated with me, and I thought, wow, I would like to be involved with that. So when I went to school, I had to declare a major, and I started out in biology, and I took an entomology course, and I'm like, wow, this is really cool. Mm-hmm. So I got involved in entomology. Mm-hmm. And I have a degree from UC Riverside. UC Riverside is everybody thinks it's kind of a quiet campus, but it's actually world famous. It's the center of biological control in California for sure, and probably the nation. Biological control is the science of using predators and parasites to control pests.
Okay.
And it can be any kind of a pest. It can be an insect. It can be a plant. For example, out on Santa Cruz Island, they had a terrible problem. Somebody brought some cactus over, and the cactus started taking over.
Okay.
And
never think of cactus being invasive.
Oh, it was invasive bad. And the owners of Santa Cruz Island at the time asked the university for help, and the university sent some entomologists over there, and they said, is there something we can introduce on this island that will control this plant? And sure enough, they found a couple of insects and transported them over there. End of problem. Now you can barely find cactus on Santa Cruz Island. But probably the most important instance of biological control was back in the 1880s. The citrus industry was a big thing back then. California was in a sleepy agricultural state. Mm-hmm. And we had a lot of orange trees and lemon trees and lime trees and that kind of stuff. And an insect called the cottony cushion scale came over and just started decimating the citrus growths. The citrus trees were dying off left and right. Mm-hmm. And they were going to put them out. So the call went out to the citrus experiment station, which is what UCR was called back then. And they figured out where the cottony cushion scale came from. They went to its home place, which is Australia, and found a beetle called the Bedelia beetle, and brought it back. And the Bedelia beetle did a good job of controlling the cottony cushion scale and the more temperate parts of Southern California. Okay. Now, in the inland parts where it's hot, 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 hot in the summer, they found a fly that's a parasite of the cottony cushion scale, and it handles the cottony cushion scale. So together, these two insects, and I think that's Cryptochetum something, I can't remember, Icerii probably.
So that's like the control of a biological pest.
And this was back in the late 1880s. So this was, 130, 140 years ago.
So they figured that out a long time ago.
Right, okay. And the big advantage is if you control using natural parasites and predators, you're going to have to use pesticides.
True.
Okay.
So that's the good part.
So, and you go out to UC Riverside, and they've got building after building for rearing insects, for evaluating possible parasites and predators of pest insects. So that was why I went to school at UC Riverside. I got my bachelor's. To be honest, I went up, started working on a master's up in Carleton University in Ottawa, Canada, studying a group of flies that were a parasite on oak weevils that get into the acorn. Mm-hmm. And boy, talk about an interesting life cycle. Very interesting. But that somewhere along there, I figured out that I guess being a successful entomologist is kind of like being a successful NFL football player. Only the top 0.1% get to be there. Everybody wants to be. Well, it's the same way with entomologists. It's hard to believe, but there aren't that many opportunities for entomologists. And I realized I didn't have the right personality to work in a large organization such as the government. So I went out, followed my father into his trade, which was tool and die making, and I became, dropped out of school, became a tool and die maker.
They made good money.
They used to make good money. Not anymore. They shipped it all overseas now.
When they were working in their prime here in the United States, they were very good craftsmen, so they demanded a lot of money.
They're still good craftsmen, but it's a worldwide market now.
The market's shrinking. I mean, the employment is shrinking within the United States.
Okay. So that's what I did. I retired this year earlier, and
somehow you landed in the leisure world.
Oh well, yeah. I met my wife Linda. Linda plays accordion for ballroom dancing.
Are you related to the famous Linda Herman?
That's it.
Accordion player, yes, one woman band.
That's Linda.
Okay.
And that's my wife, and we got together and got married, and she said, well, if we're going to get married, you're going to move into leisure world. And I said, okay. So that's what's happened.
Yeah. Very good, very good. Okay, now we went through some photos that you brought, and they were interesting little critters, and one photo had a fly on a purple flower with a yellow center. And why would a fly be on a flower? Usually I think a fly is on rotting food and stuff like that and laying maggots. Why would we have a fly on a flower and there's an aphid there?
Well, the aphid just happened to be there.
Okay.
The fly was probably lapping up some of the nectar for energy so that it can continue flying. That particular fly, I'm pretty sure, is what's called a tachinid fly. And tachinid flies are parasites of other insects.
Okay.
So it needs a quick pick-me-up, so it's like stopping at the 7-Eleven, so to speak, getting a pick-me-up so it can continue looking for
victims,
on which to lay his eggs.
Okay.
Or her eggs, I'm sorry.
Okay, so I just didn't know that flies went around like bees.
Oh, almost. There are very few insects that don't feed. Bali.
Okay.
Mayflies.
Mayflies?
Mayflies that are, you don't see them so much out here in California, but back east, mayflies come out in the zillions, and the adults only live for one day. And it's a big orgy for one day, and then the females lay their eggs, and the mayfly adult dies after one day. So the mouth parts, actually, in that insect are vestigial, don't even work.
Don't even work just one day, huh?
Just for one day. And so that insect, its whole life is basically as a larvae, and mayflies live underwater in a stream, and that's your fly fishermen or big mayflies observers, because what they do when they make their little fly fishing lures, they're trying to emulate the look of the mayfly.
So fool the fish.
So to fool the fish. That's correct.
Yeah. So fishermen are not that dumb. They're pretty smart too.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Now you also had a photo of a black and white long looking thing called a
Cerambycid beetle.
Oh, that's what I meant to say. What are those?
Those beetles, when you go out into the wilderness, and you know there'll be a log knocked over and the bark's knocked off, you'll see holes in the body of the tree, a quarter inch, maybe 3/16 of an inch, either round holes or oval holes. And Cerambycid beetles make,
Because they bore into the...
Yes, they bore into the wood.
Okay.
The larvae bore into the wood. I'm pretty sure cerambycid beetles make the oval holes, and the buprestid beetles, which are metallic wood-boring beetles, make the round holes. But I could have that backwards.
Okay.
This getting old is terrible.
Okay, so then you had a fly, looked like a fly to me, on an, it's orange, it's a large photo,
mm-hmm.
and you call it a photo micrograph of a fly. What is a photo micrograph, first of all?
Okay, most cameras can't get close enough to an insect to take a good picture of it,
mm-hmm.
and I had set up years ago and tried to take a picture through my microscope, and wasn't too successful. I have to apologize for the quality of that particular image, but that's how you take it. And the big telephone looking pole through the center of that fly is long dead, and that's an insect pin that looks like a tiny, tiny little wire when you pick it up.
Okay, but it looks like a telephone pole when you...
When you put it under the microscope.
Okay, got it. Okay, now you also have, it looked like a green leaf, and you corrected me, it was not a green leaf, with a SYR fit maggot eating. It's a brother.
What that is it's a syrphid maggot. Syrphids are a family of flies. And all baby flies are called maggots, and these maggots live on in the foliage of your plants everywhere. And what they eat is they eat aphids.
Okay. So they're good guys.
They're good guys.
Eating the bat.
And they're in that particular picture. You'll see he's eating. You can't see the head of the maggot because it tapers down to a point naturally. Okay. And but he's chowing down on a maggot, and the next part of the meal, the second course, is sitting there just waiting to be eaten.
That's dessert coming up. Okay.
Yep.
Okay, very good.
And that is a perfect instance of how biological control works. They'll bring these flies in, and when you're at a flower, you'll see these flies, and they never seem to land. They just hover right there.
Yes.
That's the adult of the syrphid fly. They're called hoverflies for that reason.
There's a professional photo of a wasp, Tamarixia. Is that?
Mm-hmm. Tamarixia.
What's one of those wasps?
Those wasps lay eggs in an insect called a psyllid. A psyllid is an insect that no one hardly ever sees. And this Tamarixia wasp will lay its eggs in the egg of the psyllid. Okay, so I mean, we're talking really, 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 really small.
So this guy's laying an egg in an egg.
Okay, and this Tamarixia is one of the parasites that's been brought in to handle what's called the Asian citrus psyllid. Asian citrus psyllid is here in California. It's all over the place.
Now that's bad, right?
It's a bad thing. It is the vector. It's the means by which a disease of citrus called Long Bing Long, I think.
Okay, that's pretty close.
Or citrus greening disease, which is a bacterial infection that citrus trees get. Okay, the psyllid spreads it.
Okay,
and somewhere in there, we have a picture of a map of Southern California, and all the blue squares are where the psyllid is. The area that's surrounded by red are quarantine areas that you're not supposed to move any citrus out of because of the spread of this disease. This disease is inside that red area.
Well, that map shows that Seal Beach is right on the border, or Lee
right on, right on the border. Right on the border, right. Now, I got a flyer the other day, and it was those circles were much smaller. Much smaller.
So it's growing.
And it's basically quadrupled in size in just like the last couple of months. Okay, so this is something that's really moving really quickly. The citrus greening disease will, if it is allowed to grow unchecked, mm-hmm. will decimate California's citrus industry.
Okay, not to mention that, we also have a graph from Florida.
From Florida.
And it's a 15-year span or so?
15-year span, if you look at it. And you can see Florida's millions of tons of citrus, and then just
almost going down to zero.
Almost going down to zero. This citrus greening disease is decimating the Florida citrus industry.
So if it decimated Florida, and it's now in California.
It's now in California, and they are trying to control it. So that's why this is. The psyllid,
it's important.
It's important.
Yeah, that wasp is super important if it can control
right.
that.
Yeah. Right. So it's we're on. This is brand new, HLB, Wong Bing. That's the name of the disease. Okay. I'm sorry. This getting old is a bummer.
Yeah, I wish we could bypass that part. Yeah. It's called ACD
is Asian citrus psyllid.
Okay, then there's a dash HLB.
HLB is a Chinese word
for the disease.
Wong Bing.
Okay,
got disease. It. And also the common name in America is citrus greening disease. And what happens is your citrus tree starts, the fruit half ripens and dies, mm-hmm. and the tree dies. Okay, so this is a very serious, very, 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 very serious disease.
Okay.
And Leisure World, believe it or not, is right on the edge of it. They, professor that gave this talk says out of 10 homes, 6 will have citrus trees in their yard. And the citrus trees that are in residences are acting as a reservoir of this disease. So it's real important to know the symptoms, and I can't give you the symptoms.
Okay.
The leaves look mottled, but instead of being the whole leaf mottled, it's part of the leaf looks mottled and part looks healthy. Okay. And when you see that, it's time to call the California Department of Agriculture and have them come out and look at it.
Wow.
I can't.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
So it's really serious. I mean, truly and honestly is.
Okay.
And.
So we could. So our citrus industry in California could be devastated if it's not controlled.
That's
pest control.
That's a very true statement.
All right. Okay, anything else? You scared us enough with that one.
Well, this is what happened back in the 1880s.
Okay.
They started losing the citrus industry to cottony cushion scale, and brought the predators and parasites of that cottony cushion scale into California. End of problem.
Save us.
Yeah, it saved the citrus industry for 130 years. Now we have a new problem.
Okay.
And
another challenge to overcome if we don't want to lose that industry.
That's right. As you can imagine, it's many, many billions of dollars and lots of jobs, thousands and thousands of jobs.
Yeah.
So.
Well, John, well, fantastic. Thank you for sharing all that information with us. And hopefully we'll do it another time when you have another interesting insect story.
Anytime. Yeah.